request Dr. Venkatramanan to deliver his talk, and all the participants please mute or your speaker so that we enjoy the information or the knowledge being imparted by Dr. R. Venkatramanan. Please.
Thank you so much, sir, for the introduction.
Sir, just a minute. I will change the mic to presenter. Yes, sir. Now you can start sharing the screen, sir. Dr. Venkatramanan, sir.
My screen is visible. Yes. Sir, good morning, sir. Good morning, everybody. First of all, I invite the dignitaries, ISVPT members, and other participants for this webinar, and thank ISVPT for giving me this opportunity to share my experience with respect to biostatistics and also some of the web tools we use for testing this system. So I think biostatistics, though I am specialized in animal genetics and breeding, biostatistics is actually statistics applied to biological sciences. And in this regard, I start with the famous quote of Sir Albert Fisher: to call in the statistician after the experiment is done may be no more than asking him to perform a postmortem examination and be able to say what the experiment died of. So this says everything about statistics. That is, even when I do statistics for my own students, so most of them come to me after the experiment with data. You see the data, then you see you could have had one control, then the data could have been measured like this. But at that stage, you can only identify the problem. So everything should start from designing. So what is statistics? Statistics is the study. It starts from actually collection of data up to getting inferences from that. But actually, it actually starts even before that. That is from the designing of experiment. And all this collection, classifying, summarizing, and inferences, when applied to biological sciences like our veterinary science, pharmacology, toxicology, etc., then it's called as biostatistics. But we biologists are always, we have a fear of statistics because of the intense calculations, and so always, because we are not experienced in mathematical sciences, and once because of this complex calculations, we were actually afraid of statistics. But now, to our help, we have got very good software applications. That is, advancement in computational technology has actually helped us. So it does everything. So there is no need to worry about the calculations and computations. So immediately, in seconds, you get your results. Previously, in our class, we used to take 1 3-hour class to do one ANOVA, calculating all the sum of squares, everything. But I don't know if this is a boon or bane. So actually, software will give you the results only for the input you give. So as biologists, we just cannot say that I have the software, I have given the data, I'll get the analysis. So you need to know what is the type of analysis, why are we doing that, and there is no need to go into the deep calculations and derivations that is with statistical techniques. But you must know why this is done, what is your data, what is your experiment about, so that you give the right input and get the right output from the software. So why biostatistics? So first of all, so in this slide, I'm going to tell you some applications why biostatistics is important. Then we go to that, and at the end of the presentation, I'll also be showing some of the demonstrations. So first thing is, whatever we collect, so we collect so much of data, it is numerous animals, observations. You see those, you don't get any idea, but statistics helps us present it in a better way and draw inferences. Then repeatability, the most important thing. See, nobody who is going to do research, they are not at all interested in our own 6 animals or 8 animals what we do. Actually, they are sacrificing themselves to give a very good application for the whole population, and there the findings which we find should be applicable into the population. What I mean, population is the whole world, the same conditions, you must be able to repeat the experiment, and statistics is the one which gives us that confidence. You can tell with confidence my experiment when done by others can be repeated with such accuracy. It gives us something about precision as well as applicability as to how much it could be repeated and what are the conditions, so that other readers could take very valuable information from that. Then the confidence, again the confidence could be given in terms of an interval. So there's no need for you to tell that this is my result. You could give this could be the range of interval within which my results are going to be useful. Then hypothesis testing. See, in pharmacology most of the drugs are tested, so you can very confidently say my drug is effective, not effective, because just by seeing the results everybody will say that the mean is high, my drug is effective. It's not that. You need to have a statistical significance to say that my drug is effective or not effective. So prediction, so to know about the future. See, we here prediction is based on absolute data where lots of biostatistical tools are being used, like regression, nonlinear regression, modeling, and big data analysis. Everything is for prediction from data where several biostatistical tools are being used. And finally, you have a big group, you want to classify them based on several variables. You have several biological biostatistical tools for classification. And again, to know about the sensitivity, see, like now we are in a COVID era, we want to know, test some diagnostic. So you have some, already you have a diagnostic, you can compare. For all these things, you need a good biostatistic tool. So biostatistics is growing day by day. And in this 1 hour webinar, I don't know how much I'll be able to cover. So what I thought was, instead of telling you different topics on biostatistics, how could I make this topic a complete one? So I thought I would take some guidelines, so that for this, when we see the participants list, most of them are biological scientists who are going to do research on biological sciences. So I thought I could take some list of checklist and say what are all the biostatistical tools available to complete this checklist, so that we are contented that we have completed all the needs for our experiment with respect to biostatistical tools. I am not going to touch the other parts of the checklist, and for this I took the help of Prepare and Arrive. What is this Prepare and Arrive? So the NORICOPA, that is Norway's 3R group, they have come out with Prepare guidelines, that is how you must be prepared before an experiment, biological experiment. Before doing it, you have to checklist. It has a checklist of 15 points. And similarly, the ARRIVE. ARRIVE is a list of points for animal research reporting in vivo experiments. So this comes after your experiment is complete. When you want to report an experiment that has been used with animals, you are supposed to give a list of points. There are about 20, I'll be showing that. So these are the 15 points recommended by Prepare. So in this, if you see the fourth one, the experimental design and statistical analysis is foremost importance. And then if you see, this is under the Prepare stage, and when you come to the Arrive stage, you can see the 20 points. And if you say that I have completed all these 20 points, your research is going to be reproducible. You can tell with confidence that I have done all that is required for a scientific experiment. But I'm so sure we cannot completely do all 20. But you do a checklist, and what ARRIVE recommends is, even if you're not able to do, you say the conditions and the problems or the reason for which you could not do these points, so that others will be able to work on that point, so that that problem could be solved. So if you see in this ARRIVE guidelines, 6, 10, 11, 12, 13, 15, and 16, all are for interim validity and all are related to biostatistics. So even that's why biostatistics is so important, and even though it is mainly dependent on mathematics, we biologists as researchers should know about at least some basics of biostatistics. And So with this guidelines, I'm going to go one by one. And so this, as a finally, you will have to combine both prepare and arrive, and finally see that your experiment has, this is not clear, I'm just given the slide for combination of prepare and arrive because they are complementary to each other. I'll give you the website. So good thing about arrive is that just July 2020, thanks for Dr. Srinivasan and CCLAS, they had shared me this paper on arrive guidelines. It is so new, just July, they have come out with the latest output of arrive. There are two papers. The second paper is a 65-page report, which
by
actually
the patient.
All people involved in biological research to go through these pages because it gives wonderful explanations with examples so that you can set your experiment according to the guidelines. And these guidelines, once you follow, you will not miss out on any statistical or even other experimental animal issues with respect to your experiment. So now, these arrive in the latest issue of 2020. They have divided 20 into essential 10, which is includes from study design to results. If you see these 10, study design, sample size, inclusion and exclusion criteria, randomization, blinding, outcome measures, statistical methods, and the 10th one results, all are dependent on statistics. So see how much statistics play a role in our experiment. Except for the experimental animal and experimental procedure, our biostatistics application comes into almost 8 of the arrives essential 10. And then what they have done, they just gave little lenience to the remaining 10. Then that became, sorry, 11. It has become 11 now. And that is almost about the way you present and the ethical side and the husbandry side. So these are recommended. And for these, they recommend it. If possible, you follow. But the essentials are very important. And several journals are actually good journals worldwide are asking for you to have details on all these. So now I go to the actual presentation of biostatistics with this introduction. And for easy understanding, so always statistics is not so easy to understand. So I have taken one example. You can see the brown letters in the whole presentation will be for the example. So a very simple example, because our participant group is a very heterogeneous group. I saw the list. So for everybody to understand, I have not taken very complex designs. I have taken a very simple design so that everywhere I will use this example for better understanding. The example is simple effect of drug A on plasma glucose level. So this is the experiment which has come into the mind of the scientist. So that is the scientific question to be answered. So what we do an experiment for which we record some variables, and this experiment is done on a sample, and from the sample you calculate a statistic, and this statistic is subject to hypothesis test results, and these results are going to tell you whether this drug had an effect or not. But nobody is interested about our sample, but this sample has to be extrapolated for a population, and that is the big challenge for the statistician or the statistical design. So at this stage, we have to understand a very important point. All of us know this. It's a very basic statistical thing. So whichever experiment we do, we are not at all worried about the animals which we use and the results we get. So the total thing is the population. So we are always want a result for the population. And from this population, see, you can have several samples. You have a green here, a red here. And now we can say that you get a result from this green, you get a result from this red. Never these two are going to be the same. And again, you get the result from this. And if possible for a smaller population, you see if you can get some values for the whole population, never the result from a sample is going to be the same as that for the population. So always there lies a degree of uncertainty. And the statistician's role is to estimate this uncertainty and tell to the world that so much of my sample tells that it could be applied with this much confidence in the population. So now, now knowing about the population for our experiment, the first step is now you have the idea effect of drug A on plasma glucose. First thing what you have to do is you have to form the null hypothesis. This all of us know. All of us have studied this. Always the null hypothesis is something for where we always tell that when we go into the experiment, we never expect any results. So it is drug A does not have an effect on plasma glucose. Then the alternate is just the other way around. Drug A has an effect. So finally, from this experiment, we just want to know whether which one is getting accepted, which one is getting rejected. So here, two important concepts of hypothesis testing has to be understood very well, because these are the ones which are going to be important for sample size estimation and other inferences from the experiment we are going to do. So these are called as type 1 error and type 2 error. Type 1 error is nothing but false positive. That is, what is the null hypothesis? Null hypothesis is drug A does not have. See, if in the whole population, drug A does not have an effect, then you give a small error, because statistics is always probabilistic, it's not deterministic. You give a small error. Usually we keep it at 5% or 1%. That is what is the basis for our telling it as significant at 5% or 1%. So that is, if null hypothesis is true, you give a small error chance, that is called as alpha. See, everything is same. In statistics, another problem is there are too many terminologies for the same thing. And when you read, that causes confusion. So once you know what it is, it becomes very easy to understand statistics. So here it is also called as level of confidence. We call it alpha. Whatever it is, the type 1 error is false positive, so it is alpha. The other error is beta, the type 2 error. It is the other way around. That is, you have a false null hypothesis, but you accept it. So in that case, it is a type 2 error. This is very important in terms of sample size calculation. It is called as beta. And 1 minus beta is the power. Always every journal asks for the, or article asks for the power of an experiment. I'll be giving in detail how to calculate this power, and also give you a nice web tool for calculation of power. We will see in the future slides. So these are the, this is the representation. That is the truth in the population. If the truth is no effect and you fail to reject, then it is correct. But if you are not able to, if not you reject HO, that becomes alpha. The other thing is beta. So type 1 error is false positive and type 2 error is false negative. So this is the statistical representation with the usual normal curve. If you see, this is our null hypothesis curve, and the good thing about alpha is this alpha is in the hands of the researcher. So you fix whether it is 5% or 1%. But always 1% is better. See, the probability of making an error in alpha becomes less. But when you go on reduce this alpha, what will happen? Beta will creep up. Beta is not in the hands of the researcher. And that is why we cannot just like that fix alpha at any 0.1% and tell that I'm going to do a very stringent experiment. Once you go for a stringent experiment, automatically your beta will creep in. So always have a balance between alpha and beta. This is just for an understanding on these two types of errors, which we need for calculation of sample size. Next, now I go into the actual guidelines. So I'm starting from ARRIVE 1 itself, so that we complete one by one, and at the end of the presentation, we'll be completing a full topic on study design. So first thing is study design. So all of us have studied experimental design. What is our design? Our design, the ARRIVE asks us to give the number of groups, the positive or negative control, the treatment groups. So for example, if you already have a standard therapy, then always it is better to have a positive control. If you don't have anything such, always go for a negative control. So in our experiment, so I have gone for one treatment and one control. So the treatment is given with drug A and the control is given with normal saline. I'm also, at this stage, I'm also giving one example of a very recent study on COVID-19 vaccine. So if you see, actually there, I told you we are giving a vehicle normal saline. So why are we giving this normal saline? So the experimenter has to treat both the treatment as well as control group in the similar manner. So your intervention, that is, you give it as an injection or whatever it is, the discomfort cost to the animal should be equal for both the groups. So in this example, if you see, even they are using a vaccine itself as a control. So why they have used such a vaccine in this corona studies? So vaccine sometimes tend to cause some systemic reactions, and these reactions should be uniform in the both the groups. So instead of a vehicle of normal saline, they have used in the study a very similar vaccine as a control group. So this is about the controls. Now, what is the second part? What are the experimental units in your study? So you are going to use animals. So whether each animal is one experimental unit. For example, in our case, we have used diabetic mice as the experimental unit. This identification of the experimental animal, all these things, the researcher knows well from the review of literature and earlier studies. So here, what you have to decide is whether each mice is an experimental unit or a group of animals is going to form an experimental unit. So where will you use a group? See if you expect any mortality or certain states, traits are to be studied as a group and take an average like feed efficiency traits. So in that case, you will have more animals in an experimental unit, and this you have to decide because your sample size is going to be for the experimental unit and not for the individual animal. So when you do a preparation or experimental design, what you have to do is you decide about your experimental unit and calculate the sample size accordingly, because your software will give you only the number of units, experimental units per group. So if you want to have more number of mice or something, initially you can decide for your number of animals with the ethical committee. So this is about the design. So here I'm going to introduce you to an important web tool. So through the presentation, I'll just introduce the web tools, and finally afterwards, because some streaming problem, I thought demonstration could be kept together at the end of the PowerPoint. So for more complex design, see now our design is very, very simple. I just told you there are two groups and there are one control and treatment. When you go in for complex groups with more number of groups, animals, interventions are repeated. See, a nice flow diagram like this will help you give a checklist. And this is from NC3R's website, Experimental Design Assistance. It is wonderful. It helps you at every stage, and all biostatistical tools are built in, and they also critically review your experimental design. And before going into your presentation or project approval, once you do it with EDA, most of your questions are answered here itself. And I'll be showing you the basic example at the end of the slide, because time is very short. So just for you to show that EDA is a very good web tool for formation and making our experimental design very, very in a correct, right manner. And this also forms as a checklist, and it gives a wonderful report of 3 to 4 pages in which your entire experiment is given in a very illustrative and complete manner. So now we pass on to the second item. Second item is the most important thing. I think most of you would have faced this problem while presenting to the ethical committee. There always is the issue of agreement when it comes to sample size. There are so many schools of thoughts, and most of the researchers nowadays, whenever we go for a meeting, they always have this magical number of 6. So this 6, I don't know how it became like that. Maybe it is because of the basic method of sample estimation, where you expect an error degrees of freedom of above 12. And so for that, 6 per group would be sufficient. But now with the advent of computational technology and with animal welfare issues very given much of importance, it is very important for you to justify your sample size. You cannot just like that say that I have taken 6 animals, 3 animals, 10 animals. And again, the number of groups already I told you, there itself you decide whether the, see, for example, in our experiment, there are only 2 groups. You all decide the number of treatments, whether it is absolutely necessary, because number of treatments is more, your number of animals are more. Then comes the number of animals per group. That is your sample size. And the ARIVE guidelines expects you to tell you the number of experimental units per group, the total number of experimental units, that is for all the groups. In our case, 6 per group I have just taken. it becomes 12 because each animal is an experimental unit and total number of animals used. See, here it is 12, but when you have more number of animals per experimental group, it should become more. Now, this sample size is otherwise the replication, and all of us, we know replication is the primary principle of experimental design. Why this replication? So if you see, and when I take just one mouse per group, the same thing, drug A and vehicle, what happens? I have lower glucose level. I can just say that drug A has effect on this plasma glucose. But when I take 10 mice per group, you can see that, see, if you just see this mouse, which was with vehicle, and this one, in fact, plasma glucose is more. And if you just would have taken by mistake only these two, you would have told that drug A actually causes an increase in blood glucose. So to account for this within group variability, it is very important for you to replicate, and how much to replicate is a big question which will be answered now. So that's what the second part of ARRIVE guidelines asks you, how you arrived at this sample size. Now, how do we arrive? See, if you see, when the sample slowly starts increasing, sample size increasing, my values slowly go and start and reach the population, and that is our goal. But for that, we cannot go on increasing, because once after a particular thing, see, our cost of experiment and animal welfare issues crops in. So you have to find out a very, very optimal number of animals which will help you, give you the best results for your population, as well as don't take away too many animals. Too few animals, a total waste, because the experiment itself is going to be a waste. You can't use the results. Too many animals, a partial waste, because you are wasting the animals and you are also troubling them, as well as the cost of the experiment. So now, you how to go about, what is needed? Now you are at the designing stage. Before going into the meeting, you have to justify your sample size. So first thing needed is your primary measure. What is that which you are going to measure, and based on which you are going to give your results. In our case, it's plasma glucose. So this is the glucose, because all parameters you want to know is for this parameter, plasma glucose. Now, I said significance threshold. Already I explained about the type 1 error. I keep it as 0.05 for this. Alpha is 0.05. This is with the researcher. So you fix that. Then comes one more question, directionality. So directionality. So one tailed or two tailed test. So someone has to mute their audio. I'm getting an echo.
Participants, please mute your audio. Please don't disturb the presenter. Kindly mute your audio as well as your video. Please.
Yeah, thank you. So directionality. So one take or this take. What is this? One take or two take? I think, thank you. So this is the explanation for a one tail or two tail. So let us take our plasma glucose. So now, if you are very sure that plasma glucose is going to reduce the the drug A is going to reduce the plasma glucose, then you can go for a
sir, please just wait for a second. I'm just muting it.
Again, one chat is disturbing me.
Mute,
thank you. I think it's okay now.
That's why you muted only.
Dr. Deepak Sharma, please stop your video also. Dr. Deepak Sharma, please stop your video. Yeah, sir, you can continue now.
Yeah, thank you. So now we are talking about the third point of directionality, which is one and two tail test. So here, now if I am very sure that my drug is going to reduce the plasma glucose, then I know that I just want to see whether how much, whether the difference, the reduction is going to be significant or not. In that case, I can go for a one-tailed test. So only thing I want to see is one side of the parameter. So now, if you want to see that whether there is a difference between two groups, that is, the difference can be on either side. In this case, you need to go for a two-sided two-tailed test. So here, the thing will be, it is not equal to mu zero, and here mu one will be less than mu zero. Why this difference is, once you have alpha on the left side, so you have a larger area of alpha, and I already showed you that graph just for this reason. Once you have a larger alpha, your beta will be minimum. So your power of experiment will be more. So if you are very sure, but be very sure and see for review and confirm that this drug is going to bring it down. So otherwise, anything above will not be taken into consideration in a one-tailed test. So coming after now, the fourth information. Already I have told three things, just to again I'm repeating those three because this is a very important thing: the outcome measure, alpha, and directionality. Now the fourth thing is something effect size. I think this should be a bit new, because even when we started our Thalassa training with Ramesh sir, we had actually brought this into the thing for power size calculation, and this effect size. So the predefined effect size, what is this? So every researcher should understand his variable very well, and again this is in the hands of the researcher. That is, if I am taking plasma glucose, first you must know what difference is something different. That is, I have two groups. These two groups, for example, one group has 280 milligrams per deciliter, another group has 283 grams milligrams per deciliter. Just 3 grams difference. Is this a difference? So this amount, like whichever trait it is, the same thing, if you are studying something about nanoparticles, even a small difference could be a actual difference. So this you have to decide. And for our example, actually GDA, for this example, they have taken a difference of 100 milligrams per deciliter as a biological difference. And this difference M1 minus M2, this is for the absolute value, whatever is the difference between the groups we expect, divided by average ST of the trait. So which trait? The plasma glucose. Already you must know some variability about this response variable, and with that you get something called effect size. So because the software for power size calculation will ask you effect size, it is nothing but what is the difference which as a researcher you will deem it to be actually different. So based on this Cohen's-D, you can even classify the effect size as small, medium, and large. And here what we have to understand is, if you want to prove a very small effect as significant, your sample size has to be large. And for a large effect, your smaller sample size itself is sufficient for proving that effect. So if it is for a large effect, then no need to go in for unnecessarily too many number of animals. The fifth information for sample size calculation is variability. So now variability for the trait, standard deviation is the most important thing. I told you we are using that standard deviation here to calculate the effect size. And how will you get this variability? It is based on previous experiment. If your response measure is new and nobody else has studied this, then comes the question of pilot study. So your ethical committee will approve you a pilot study only if you say that there is no information on this, and such pilot studies are done with a minimum size of 10. So from this you could get some information about the variability. Otherwise, very easy ways to get this from already published articles. You can take the ST from pooled variance, or from the square root of the residual variance from NANOVA, or from the standard error. Most of the studies, they report standard error or their mean. Have given the formula, and also Cohen's-D, some of them given their sample size calculation Cohen's-D, and it is one of SD is one of the important parameters for Cohen's-D. So now you have these five information, and the next important information. So for our sample study, that is our study on plasma glucose, I have taken this as 50. Now The important thing for sample size calculation is the power, or 1 minus beta. I already explained beta, and this is very important because this is what is going to tell the power, actual power of an experiment. That is, see this black area, this is the region where actually my drug A has an effect on glucose and I am going to reject. So if that is, what does it mean? This is the actual effect in the population. So this is the region, and if I reject, then that area, don't worry about the statistical part, just understand there is effect of drug in the population and my sample also is going to reject. What is that? The power, and that is nothing but 1 minus beta. So how to what is the significance of this power for any experiment is accepted, at least you have a minimum power of 80%. So if your study is less than 80%, then whatever you have done is a waste, because just having a power of less than 80%, the whole experiment goes a waste. So this is a very important parameter. So this will better explain the power. See, when I had 6 per group, what happens? My power is 70%. I increase the sample size. All this we'll be seeing in the web tool of GPower also. It increased to 94%. So the sample size, as it increases, see, the variability parameters of my curve also has narrowed down, and the difference between the control and treatment is slowly increasing. Actually, whenever there is confusion, you have an overlapping between these. So as sample size increase, and this is the role of the statistician, that is, what is the actual size which will give you the actual difference you want between these two hill peaks. So for that, we keep a parameter called power. Now here it is 94%. If it is only for 80%, even lesser than this is sufficient. Okay, so one of the studies, Barkan 2015, so in this study he says 70% of the studies which he reviewed was actually without any value of power and which gave negative results. So in these studies, if power would have been calculated for 80%, maybe that sample size would have made that drug itself significant, because increasing the sample size, even a smaller effect, I already told you, even a smaller effect is could be significant by increasing the sample size. So for now, the information so far which I have discussed for the our experiment. So it is plasma glucose, effect size, I told you it's 2. Now, level of significance 5%, so it is actually 0.05, and power is 85%. I've kept 85% on a safer side, I think 5 above the recommended level. So this is GPower. So I just need this information, because GPower is a software that is going to calculate, because power calculation actually involves computational things based on the, because non-centrality parameters have to be calculated. So instead, the software is going to do this for us. GPower has been quoted or cited in several papers, and even EDA uses GPower for calculation of power. So here it asks for two-tailed or what? See the effect size, the alpha, and the power. Everything you have, this allocation is nothing but how many number of animals you need in each group. Again, this is important. So when there are equal number of animals in your treatment and control, your sample size requirement will be less. I'll show you how altering this will change the sample size. So the software gives you the actual power here, and the sample size that is required for getting a power of 85% at 5% alpha and an effect size of 2. So this is 6 and 6, and the magical 6 has come here by coincidence. So please don't think that 6 is always the sample size. 6 can come by calculating all this information, but 6 should not be taken by ourselves without taking any efforts to finalize our sample size. About GPower, it also helps us in effect size calculation apart from power analysis. The calculator also gives for statisticians other parameters with respect to power calculation, and it's a free software for Mac and Windows, and the reference I've given, it is free, as a free software, downloadable, very easy to use, and every one of you can use once you understand the 6 points which I explained in the previous slides. Now, not only that, power experiment gives us a wonderful graph. See, it also, see, now I told 85%, for which it was 6, that is 12 in two groups, total sample size. Here it is total sample size. Again, you don't get confused. Sample size is usually given as per group, But here in this graph, it is total sample size of 12 for 0.85. And as you increase the power, you see sample size also increases. From this graph, you can choose the number of animals for the power you want to achieve. Okay, there are other good softwares which are free, 5-phase power, or scripts for power. This reference is very good. For complex experiments, you can use R. It's a very good platform for all statistical analysis. And EDA. EDA does the power analysis, but the basics web tool it uses is again GPower. And for some designs which you don't have in GPower, PaaS 2020 is a paid software. It has several other options, but being a paid software, it should be taken by an institute or something to calculate power. So an important thing on replication and sample size is over. So I just gave this example as to how the scientist has actually explained. So the tool used and the parameters used and how he came into the sample size used, a total of 20 dogs per group were used in this experiment, just for you to have an example how these parameters help and how the representation helps in improving the quality of the paper. Okay, so once now replication is over, I wantedly missed arrive item number 3 because that was more related to a section later there, and I wanted to have replication and randomization together. Now randomization is actually the second important principle of experimental design. What is this randomization? Now I have 12 animals in two groups. So I have purchased the 12 mice. All these 12 animals should be given an equal chance of going into either the treatment or control. This is the simplest explanation for randomization. Now, if all these 12 animals are exactly same in terms of age, sex, everything, then I can go for simple randomization. But it is not the case. Sometimes you don't get the same age group of animals. You have different sex. They may be of different weight. Then statistics has the third experiment principle of experimental design. That is our local control. So you have to control for these variables because they will also have an effect on our response variable, which is plasma glucose. And that's why they are also termed as nuisance or noise variables, because the noise is that it is disturbing. And any disturbance is to the response variable, and that's why it's called as nuisance or noise variable. So you have to consider this. So what we do is you block the animal. For example, you have different numbers of male and female. You take males and randomize within the males, so that randomization also will be possible, and also your effect of sex could be included in the model. And your design, in this case, it is CRD, completely randomized design, and here it becomes randomized block design. Okay, and when you have even more number of noise factors, you can include as many factors, but as you include noise variables, your sample size will increase. You use the appropriate design for calculating your sample size. In our case, it's a very simple experiment. I have a homogeneous set of mice, and I'm just using simple randomization. And again, another term used for this noise and nuisance variable, they are called confounders. That is why confounders. Confounders actually take away the variability that is given by the actual treatment. What is the actual treatment? That is drug A in our case, and that is the effect which you want to find. And these are all going to take away the effect of that important thing. And so unless you consider all confounders in your study, your result is going to be biased. These two examples, they are from the ARIVE paper only again, from Zhao et al. And Benedetti et al. See, in this case, 12-week-old 50 rats, that is, they had a range of weights. So now the response is something, the effect is something, but the weight was only about 40 grams difference for 50 animals. So in this case, what they have done is they just randomly divided into 25 rats per group, two groups, using a function called random function in Excel. And randomization can be done by using a lottery method or a random number table, web tool. Excel is very good. I'll be showing how to use this random function at the end of this presentation. And there are randomization is EDA again, it does everything including randomization. It will send you a file containing the randomized groups to your mail ID, not your mail ID, the mail ID which you give, because usually these mails doesn't come to the experimenter for a condition called blinding, which I'll explain in the next slide. Similarly, in this case, these bulls' birth weight was actually so different, they had to block for the birth weight in the experiment. So what they did, see the size of the experiment, 905 animals with similar birth weight were blocked into one group. Like this, they had four groups. So almost it is 3,600 animals for some experiment, and for a randomized block design was used for this, in 20 pens were used for this experiment. So just for you to understand how the second principle is being explained in the paper, so that anybody doing this, the experiment will have all these conditions, and the reproducibility will come only when you know all these conditions. After randomization, we go into blinding. So what is this blinding? So nothing but you have a group of control and a treatment, and nobody should know which is treatment and which is control. This is blinding, and this blinding has to happen at several stages. See allocation, I told you, we are the ones using randomization. You allocate, and when you allocate, when you use randomization, this problem is solved. Otherwise, always the experimenter, of course, it is not knowingly, but always he expects his results to come as a significant one. So that's why any unintentional influence due to his expectation may bias the experiment. So the guidelines also recommends blinding, because several studies have found that without blinding, there was bias in the values obtained. So this blinding has to be at the time of allocation of animals. During the experiment, you have so many interventions like giving injections. The person giving this, he should also not know which is the drug and which is the vehicle, and measurement. So while measuring the animals, again, we must not know which is the treatment group and which is the control group. And even when data analysis, you have some important operations like outlier removal. And in that time also, knowledge on which is the treatment may cause a bias. So this blinding, again, So again, an example, I already showed this example for the vehicle, and here, see, to maintain blinding also, this problem of using another vaccine was used, because in using a vaccine, it results in some systemic reactions. So when you use the actual drug and you use a vehicle, easily the person will find out which group was treatment and which group was a control. So here they used two vaccines itself. One vaccine as control and the other vaccine as treatment, so that nobody could identify, and the blinding was maintained by using two vaccines. Next arrive item is 6, outcome measure. Already we know the outcome measure for our experiment, which is plasma glucose. And this is very important. Actually, we will have several outcome measure, and you have to know which is your primary outcome, which is going to tell your result. And also, because once you know the primary outcome measure, in several classes, they ask, sir, which is the measure based on which I have to calculate my sample size. So always it is better to take the primary outcome measure. And also, if there are any other measures which has more variability, then you can take that, because otherwise your sample size will not hold good for the other measure. In our case, the primary outcome measure is plasma glucose. Once you know the outcome measure, now you have to understand it. So here I have just one slide where you have to classify, because this classification is going to tell you which statistical test is going to be suitable for your outcome measure. So this is a very basic calculation. So quantitative, qualitative. Our plasma glucose is measurable one, so it is quantitative. When something tells about quality, it is qualitative. And among quantitative, you have one interval. So in interval, variables are ones where zero has a value. For example, temperature, 0 degrees centigrade has a value. In ratio, in ratio, zero doesn't have a value. For example, we have birth weight. In birth weight, zero birth weight is nothing. So any quantitative measure where zero has a value is a ratio, and usually quantitative ones are continuous. And even sometimes it may be discrete, like in the case of litter size, you will have 1, 2, 3, 4. And in continuous, you have our plasma glucose itself, which you see it is continuous. So this continuous variation will give us a parametric distribution. And now once you classify, so biologists need not go into the actual distribution and all, but you must, once you classify this, then you can know that it follows some distribution and you use a parametric test. Otherwise, you can go for a non-parametric test. So here again, qualitative, it tells about sex, color or something. And among that, you have nominal and ordinal. What's the difference? Nominal is something like yellow, green, or male and female. So each doesn't have any value fixed to that. The same thing, you measure a lesion score. There you give a grading, and that grading, like 1, 2, 3, doesn't have a quantitative meaning, but 2 is higher than 1. So that is called as ordinal. So each type of data has its own test. So once you classify the variable, then you can identify the statistical test which we want to do. And other things with respect to the outcome measure, what we have to know is, how was the data measured? See, paired and unpaired. The same animal, for example, in our own case, drug A, you have the mice as control, you give the drug, you measure the same mice after 46 hours, then that becomes a paired data. The same thing, you have two groups, you give drug A here and the vehicle here. Now there is no connection between these two, then that becomes an independent data. So this is the difference, because several students, what they do is when the number of observations are equal, immediately they go for a paired t-test. Now when the paired or unpaired t-test will depend on this type, and when the measurement again continues after 46, after 72, like that, then that becomes a repeated measures data. And for that, you have several analysis like ANOVA for repeated measures, or even you can go in for a linear mixed model with this animal itself as a random effect. That is the best way of analyzing the data, which will give you but these things will be decided by the statistician. But you as a researcher, before planning, you must know that you have done like this, and all this should come in your experimental design, so that the statistician very easily chooses the test which will give the most efficient result for you. So in our case, it is just two independent groups of mice with n equal to 6 each, and it is independent data, and my data is continuous one. So I actually go for a t-test, independent t-test. So again, to show the how you explain your response measure. So I have given two examples, just self-explanatory. Here I also, now arrive night item number 3. After knowing the outcome measure, now we go into the inclusion and exclusion criteria. I have brought this third item here because I wanted to explain outliers along with this. So what are this inclusion and exclusion criteria? Before you do the experiment, what you do is you decide as to, for example, here it is plasma glucose, but somewhere else you will have a lesion score or some complex trait. That the animal, when you measure, you have to give the conditions which classify that measurement as a trait. It should be given before and not after the experiment. Otherwise, what will happen? The researcher will be forced to go into a bias. So again, what is this outlier? So these criteria are fixed before the experiment, but during the experiment, something can happen. What is this? When you measure my control and treatment, what happens is you get some very extraordinary or extreme observations. And these observations will completely change the result. So once you see such outliers, what we can do is you can remove that, but it cannot be removed as such. So first, what you can do is you use a exploratory analysis, or even the descriptive analysis, or You can use an outlier checkbox under Explore menu in SPSS. That will give you the list of response measurements which were extreme. And once you know those measurements, then as a biologist, you have to decide whether it is a biological outlier. What is the difference between a statistical and biological outlier is, biological outlier is because of some problem in the experiment. That is, for example, one cage, the animals became sick and you cannot expect the same result for your experiment. And in that case, what happens is, you have the right to remove biological outlier, but statistical outlier you cannot just like that remove, because unnecessarily you are just removing because it had a higher value. But that higher value, if it is a possible for your group, then you are causing a bias in that experiment. So this is about outliers, very important guideline for the of ARRIVE. So be very careful in identifying and removing outliers. Don't remove outliers to get a significant result. Then comes the so this choosing the right statistical test. I already told, in my case it is t-test, and I have given this reference. It's a very good reference. Once you identify the type of variable from the classification which I gave, you have all the tests which you can use. So in the my own case, ratio and interval, I told you it is a continuous data. So in that case, I use a two sample t-test, because it was independent observation. I am using an unpaired t-test. The same data, if it was for some ordinal lesion score, then you go for a non-parametric test called Mann-Whitney test. So all this the statistician will tell you, provided you give this information. I have not given the entire table. You can take this reference for to choose the test based on your type of data. Now we go into the seventh item, which is statistical methods. The methods used in the experiment are to be reported as per this guideline. What are all the statistical methods? One is descriptive and exploratory analysis, the type of test used, and most important thing is you must tell whether all your assumptions are met. For example, in our case, the assumptions for a t-test are that it is continuous. I already told you it is a continuous data. Simple random sample, I used simple randomization. Normal distribution is assumed for this trait. I will tell you how to check whether normal distribution is to be tested. Then whether reasonably large sample was used. That is the sample size estimation. Once you do that, that question also does not arise. Finally, homogeneity of variance. What is this homogeneity of variance? I have one treatment and one control. Most of the pharmacological experiments, they do this before going into an ANOVA. So there should be the variance in the treatment and control before the experiment should be same. This is one of the important assumptions, and if this is this fails, we have some adjustments, and that I'll be showing to you in the results. So in our case, this is the descriptive statistics for plasma glucose. This you can see from any review of literature. You can take this data, and even if you have some kurtosis or skewness, that will tell you about normal distribution. Or you go to the explore function of SPSS, there you can get all normality tests. This will tell whether your data was normal. So if my data was normal, proceed with t-test. Otherwise, what is an alternative? We have heard about transformations. What is transformation? You can change the data into log, square root or arc sign. Then the converted data could be subject to the test, and if that data passes the normality test, proceed with the parametric test for the converted data, but don't forget to reconvert it back to the original form and present in the results, because otherwise the reader will get some confusion as to the actual value of the parameter. For example, plasma glucose in log will not give any meaning. So always while presenting results of mean, don't give the results you get from the software for the transformed data. This is very important, because your entire objective will be affected. So here I am just showing the results of normality tests. For these tests,
I don't have time to explain all this because we have another three or four issues of Array, and I have to show you the web tools also. So this is only thing is, if this p value is here for test of normality, the hypothesis itself is that both groups are normal. So here you should not reject, you should accept the hypothesis. So if p value is more than that, so for my data it is greater than 0.05. What is this p value? I have a separate slide that is very important in terms of inference. So after that you will understand this table. So here my test of normality is passed, so homogeneity of variance is not an issue. I am going for a t-test. Now here this is an example from the Array guidelines. Model assumptions were checked using the Shapiro-Wilk normality test and Levine's test for homogeneity. Then these are the tests which we have done for our data. And then the residuals were also examined. This is too statistical. Actually, one of the assumptions is residuals must also be not related to each other. It must be independent and form a normal distribution. Then this important line he has given in the article, some of the response variables had been transformed by applying the natural logarithm, and most importantly were back transformed for visualization of significance. So this is very important thing which you should not miss out when you use transformations. Then comes the this is the result I got from SPSS. So here if you see, this is the Levine's test for variance. And one more thing, this is an output from the software. Always never take the software will give us so many things, especially SPSS when you run it, gives so many things, not all are needed for us. You take only the things which you understand, and some of the students I've seen, they just copy this table and give it to the report. That should never be done. You just take, see, it's, what happens is, I have seen students, they see this significance value, that is, this is actually the p value, and see here it is 0.886. this is actually for Levine's test of variance, but actual t-test value is somewhere else. So if you only understand that you are doing a t-test and you take that particular thing, be very careful. That's why I told you, I don't know whether software is a boon or bane. Only if you know exactly what test you are doing, you can use the software to expectation. So this is the actual result of a t-test. Here what will tell that my drug has an effect or not is this t statistic. I had 12 animals, so degrees of freedom is 10. Now for this 10, I got a p-value. The significance is nothing but p-value. What is this p-value? The probability that my results are very, very rare. That means I have a very good probability of 0.7. So my null hypothesis is accepted, and when the value is greater than 0.05, my drug does not have an effect. So in this, whatever values I used, I just used a set of values for plasma glucose between control and treatment. Here, which should I take? Here, both are same. Because Levine's test was rejected, here both the values are actually same. Now, I told you when your Levine's test for homogeneity is gets failed, then you can take the second one. In my case, my normality was accepted. So this is how you get the inference from a result for p-value. Just go to your statistics table, see the p-value. If it's less than 0.05, it is a single star. And if it is less than 0.01, you use a double star, that is highly significant. Okay. And just for a reference, I use the ANOVA table because most of us use ANOVA. ANOVA is nothing but analysis of variance of the great R.A. Fisher. Actually, here when you have more than two means, you just partition the variance, and based on the variance, you give a F test. Again, here, this is the p value, and this will tell you whether your experiment is significant or not. Okay. And actually, I just not given. This is the results. Results are the 10th. Actually, I skipped 8th and 9th because that's not related to statistics. I'm talking about the Array guidelines. We have completed 7 now of the essential ones. Now almost we are into the end of the results. That is 8th and 9th I have skipped. So what are the results you have to give? First thing is the descriptive. So you have to describe your result. Descriptive statistics we have studied. The measures of central tendency, all those things. Then variants is very important, because all the these will be used. I told you, for the somebody who is going to do a similar experiment, he may use your standard deviation to get his power if your conditions were same. Then comes the statistical test, so the ANOVA, your p value. Then nowadays they also ask for a new thing called the effect size. Already I have explained effect size in terms of Cohen's d, and they say it as r d and odds ratio. Actually this effect size is nothing but, see, our p value, because you tell that a drug is significant when your p value is less than 0.05, but if but that result is dependent upon your sample size. I told you, when you increase your sample size, even a smaller effect will become significant. But nowadays they ask for something called effect size, which is nothing but in terms of correlation between the treatment and effect, or and odds ratio in terms of qualitative traits. No need to go into the details, it's not possible to explain it fully, but only thing you know is for your results you try to also calculate the effect size with confidence interval, because that result is not dependent upon the sample size used. Because when you reject an effect of drug, you say that for your sample size, and maybe even a smaller effect could be found significant if you increase the sample size. Okay, because you the power we fixed was for 85%. Now how to present your result? So simple descriptives. This is for a frequency data where, like, for example, you measure incidence of disease. Very simply, you give it in terms of frequency and proportions. And this is for a continuous data. You always give the mean, the standard deviation, measure of variance, and some of them, when you want to tell about the accuracy, and then you give the standard error, because standard error has the n in it, and that is a measure of precision, and standard deviation is the actual measure of variance. So when you want to know or describe some parameter in a particular group, then standard deviation is important. When you want to tell about accuracy of this estimate, your standard error is important. And see, they have also given the range. So this will not tell us about the range. So what was the minimum and maximum? So this way, all the information about data can be in thousands, but everything about the thousand data can be explained just with these three things. Okay, for a continuous data, then comes the another result. See, now a graphical illustration. See, this is a box plot. They have just shown the distribution of each data, but here what I want to emphasize is this p value. I told you, when we take get a result of 0.05 and less, you just put a single star and tell that it is significant, but that doesn't tell much about, because you have done such a big experiment, so much cost is involved. Instead, directly giving the p value will tell, because there's no much difference between 0.05 and 0.07. So other researchers can know at what level you got a XD value. So if it is more than 0.10, maybe it's okay. See, here it's only 0.07. So always try to give your p value rather than just telling that my drug was significant or not. Then the importance of p value. Actually, it is the probability of obtaining an extreme value as it is observed from our sample. So if the null hypothesis was true. So if it is extreme, the probability should be very low to reject our hypothesis. And in our case, we kept it as the alpha as 5%, 0.05. And if this is less than 0.05, I get an inference that my drug has an effect. So this is about the p-value for people who want to take inferences. So almost all my 10 essential of RF is over. And the remaining recommended ones, much of statistics is not involved. So I think we have given a complete thing what is required to fulfill these guidelines, so that we can at least know that these are the 8 things which you have to be ready before you go for an experiment. Now about statistical softwares. So Excel itself is a wonderful software. But as such, you will not have the data analysis tool pack. You will have to use the add install option. I think it's very easily available in the net. And with Excel itself, you can do even up to ANOVA, RBD, CRD, even up to regression, correlation, everything. SPSS is a very, very user-friendly software. That's why most of us stick with SPSS. But it is paid one. You need a license. These are also other paid softwares. SAS has been extensively used in our country because we had a license also. And the coding is possible. You can customize your experiment. And R is a very good platform for any new person who is interested in biostatistics and who wants to go into statistical analysis. I would recommend them to go into R, because though initially it is difficult because most of the things you have to give the inputs in terms of coding, but you can do anything with R. So you have so many packages and you just install the packages up to very complex analysis, including Bayesian models can be done with R. So these are about the softwares for general statistical analysis. And now throughout the experiment, I have been talking about the web tool EDA. EDA is actually helps you build a diagram, recommend statistical analysis, provide support for randomization and blinding, and perform sample size calculations for us. And more than anything, it gives a wonderful diagram and also a very, very nice report. So now I think it is time to go into the demonstration. I'll just show you three things, because once you see that, you'll see that how easy it is. I'll just share my other screens. I am just quitting my PPT for a moment now. So just show, I'll just show you in 1 minute a very easy method to do randomization. See, in my case, I have six animals for the control and six animals for the treatment. So using the RAND function, okay, I generate a random number, just drag it. See, now I am not influencing in any way. I just got a set of random numbers now. So just block these two columns, go to sort, custom sort, column C is my random number. I just sort it. So nowhere I don't influence anything. Only thing what I have done is, see, I got sorted this. Now I have just allotted these animals. The first animal is going to B, second B, then the four are going to A, then again B, B, A. Now randomization is over. So it's a very easy technique for you to randomize for an experiment. Now again, the next demonstration, for the want of time, I'm just rushing. So I'll go into and hope my Google screen is visible.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
So, EDA. Yeah. So EDA, so it's a very nice tool. I think those of you who are new to starting your research, now you have so many options in that. So it tells everything. So this is for my experiment on. So actually, I took this experiment. Yeah? So thanks to UBA for that also, for my explanation, so that when you check, you will have a better understanding. So for see the experiment here. Huh? So everywhere it gives you the drop down. See the experiment, the description, what is the null hypothesis, what is alternate hypothesis, effect of interest, see effect size, what was calculated. I had given you in my PowerPoint. Justification for the effect size, a small, see this is the actual effect size, a difference is considered significant. So then what is the animal used? See, it is just diabetic mice, and other things are, it may be suitable for some other experiment. You can leave the others empty. And regarding the number of animals total, it is 12, the total 12. What is the justification for your sample size? 85% power, 100 effect size, and significance level of 0.05. SD was 50. So these things I have explained in my PowerPoint. And how you allocate, see, allocation. And the experimental EDA has different square is for this animals. Allocation is around. This purple thing is for pharmacological intervention. You have very nice symbols on the left side. And it is not, you just work on it, you learn it, that's all. So group one, see, what is that? It is the control, and it is number 6. Like that, for everything, you have a nice table, you fill all these things, then close. What is the intervention? Here it is saline, and it is vehicle. See the drug, it is drug A. See also dose is given, then route of administration, anything about this intervention comes here. Then go to the what is the primary outcome? See, this color is for that response variable. So in this case, it is plasma glucose. And what? How you measure? See, all these things. Once somebody sees this, even your research fellows, they can just see this and understand the entire experiment and do what is the timing of measurement, how to measure, what is the measure, this glucose concentration. This is about the analysis. I think my photo is blocking that. So it is nothing but independent variable of interest. What was that? Drug A. What is the response variable? Outcome measure. And the difference is between this. Now, once you have it like this, you when you first time you go into EDA, always don't try to form your own models. There are 5 experiments and templates. Use a template and convert that into your requirement. So once that is over, see what are all the options available. See, if you see, critic. So I just perform a critic analysis for this. Oh, I'm sorry. In this 1 hour, I am signed out. I don't know if I have time to sign in again. Just for you to see the tools. It will tell you what are all the problems or errors in your design, so that you can correct that. Then it will also suggest an analysis. For example, when you give your experimental design of independent rats, it will suggest based on your response variable, the SD, etc. It will give our calculation again. And this randomized allocation report, it will ask for a email ID, because you should not know which is the treatment and which is the control. It will send the report only to your principal investigator or somebody else, who will alone know which is the treatment and thing. Otherwise, every experiment, the entire experiment is conducted as A and B. Nobody will know which is treatment and which is a control. And finally, you have a very, very nice report. You just click this, you will get again the problem. If I have time, I will sign in and show it to you. Otherwise, it's very easy. You just click and you can see for yourself the entire details of all your assumptions, everything will come in a 3-page report, inclusive of this color diagram, which can be saved in any format as a PDF document or an EDA file. But always try to save it as an EDA file, because next time you want to work on it, you can import the same diagram into the website. So this is about EDA. Now, next thing is, I would like to show you the this very nice software of G-Power. Actually, I should have showed this before EDA. Oh, sorry, I just clicked the stop sharing. So again,
sir, you can share, sir. Still you have the privilege.
I'll just share. I have this. Is my G-Power pop-up visible?
This is
G-Power. Very simple thing. It's not very colorful or something. You can download G-Power from the web. It's free of cost. Just install it like any app, and you click the G-Power icon. You are going to get this pop-up. Okay. So now you see. My test is t-test. You have other tests. You have f-test, exact test with chi-square, z-test, everything. In t-test, what are all the options available? See, there are so many options in t-test. In my case, it is difference between two independent means, because I told you we chose this test. So once you have chosen the test, this has to come here, because sample size will vary with the test. Then type of power analysis, what I want to do is sample size given alpha, that is my type 1 error, that is I have fixed as a researcher. Power, I had fixed 85%. Effect size I had given as, I think it was 2, because Cohen's d was calculated for a difference of 100 in plasma glucose. I divided that by an SD of 50. I got a Cohen's d of d. Even otherwise, you can just make your effect size as a broad category of small, large and medium, if it is confusing initially. So I have all this data. That is why I had explained those slides for you. You want to use the software, you have to calculate all these things, and it's not very difficult once you start doing that. Now the test is okay. What I want to do now, then I also explained one tailed or two tailed. So I'll first use a one tailed test. Okay, effect size was 2. Alpha, already I told you it is it was 5%, so it's already given as 5%, 0.05. My power was 0.85, isn't it? And this allocation, I told you it was this one, because I want equal number of observations in both the groups. So now I just calculate. Now I got 5. Then I why I got 5 is because I used a one tail test. I explained, when you use one tail test, so your alpha comes to one side, so that causes beta to reduce. Otherwise, what happens when you use a two tail test? You can see now I'll calculate. I got the 6. That's why I tell you 6 is not a magic number. 6 should come through these parameters, and not, you cannot take 6 as such. Now simply, this is a very large effect size. I just reduce my effect size to 1. So 1 means what? My effect size is 1 means my SD was 50, and so I'm reducing. That is, a smaller effect size has to be termed significant. Now when I calculate, see, my sample size goes to 19. So if a researcher wants to prove a particular quantity as significant, if he doesn't take that exact sample size, his entire research is going to be a waste. And that is why nowadays the results are being asked in terms of effect size also. See, my sample size went somewhere into 19. But this is unnecessary as far as our plasma glucose is concerned, because there is no, we want only to find that 100 difference between treatment and control is going to be significant. So if I want to again, one more thing I told you was, it gives a nice before that I'll also show you what happens because of the power, or you take a stringent test, because you only want double star. That is, if you want significance only at a 99% level, that means what, you do 100 times, you want to get your result in the population 99 times. So in that case, what happens? See how much animals you must use. It becomes 28, 28, 54. And only then you can say that it is This is the sample size that will give you a power of 85 with 1% alpha level. Then again, I want a very, very powerful test, like you are doing some toxicology study and it's very important that you cannot do so much of beta error. Then you go for a higher power, you see it goes to 32, 32, 64, and these things can be, now again I go back to 5, calculate, and let me have the same effect size what we used to do, and power size of 5 for my experience. I have a 6. Now you get one more very nice graph, which if you draw, I told you it gives you for every power, it gives you a very, very nice sample size calculation. So even now I had fixed, so actually we are planning, then you can discuss. So if we can go for 90, whether it is required for our experiment, then what is the sample size, then the, if it is, that is okay, and you can justify for this power, then it's very well okay. But all of you have to remember that this 80% is actually kept as a scale. Anything below this, most of the journals not accept your research if it is below 80. So this was about G power. So do I have a time to log in and tell or chill?
Sir, I think it is almost 12:40.
Yeah, yeah.
1.5 hours over. So yeah. Maybe the participants, if they have any clarification or doubt they have, they can write to you. I can I've shared your email ID. It is venkivet@gmail.com. So that they will kind of write to you to ask more on the EDA.
Okay.
Shall we? Is that all over, sir? Or should do you have something more? To
So that's all. Just I want to thank, that's what the last slide is, thank you, Smith. So I thank this opportunity to present before this august audience for such on basic biostatistic tools. I have just shared very basic things about things as a refresher thing. And I thank ISVPT for giving this opportunity. And again, also my colleagues at LSC for all their support and encouragement. So thank you. And now I can answer whatever questions.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you for a very informative session. Please, participants, please don't unmute your audio. Please mute all. Whatever questions you have, you can post it in the chat box. I will ask question on behalf of you. Please bear with me. So I'll start asking the questions. We have few questions coming up, so we'll start asking it. Participants, please mute your audio. Okay, the first question is on how are the sample size calculations made for non-parametric test, non-parametric data, and which software is most useful, whether it is Python or SAS?
Sample size calculation for G power uses for parametric, and whatever I have explained is mainly for parametric. As far as non-parametric, I have not used Python or SAS, but there are very good scripts in R, and I think all are giving equally good results, and I am not very sure about Python.
Okay. The next question is about you discussed about one example about the pens in randomization, or the bulls were used in randomization. So the participant has asked, what is pens in randomization? You use like a pen containing number of animals as one sample unit, or individual animal in each pen is a sample unit?
Yeah, in that case, actually the blocking was for birth weight. So blocking was for the difference in birth weight, so they had four blocks. The pens were the replications within each block. So that will be our sample size per treatment. So for example, they had four treatments. For each treatment, there were so many things.
Okay. And in slide number 44, SD is 16. The participant has referred the slide number. It's 44. SD, standard deviation is 16 in t-test. can it go up to 16 or is there any range? Slide number 44.
Actually, this data was prepared for the presentation. See, standard deviation, it tells if there is no, it doesn't have anything, it can go up to this or that. But it is the most important measure of dispersion. And when your standard deviation increases, it tells about heterogeneity of your data. And no need to worry, it is 16, because 16 is it is actually square root of the variance, and it is for that particular parameter. If you see, you take ADG, average daily gain, for that it will be very high. But for your mean, for example, my mean was 280, and for that it was 16. And for that variability, that's why we are asking you to consider that variability into the sample size calculation, so that comes into it. So if you take if your data is more homogeneous with lesser standard deviation, what will happen is your sample size will come down. So the power and sample size calculation helps us in this regard.
Okay. There's another question. Please explain how to get a desired sample number for a study. How to determine how much preliminary samples need to be processed for getting desired number from a herd? Whether preliminary number of samples analyzed affect our results for sample number.
Yeah. So again here, so we are talking about, because this was our pharmacology thing, we are talking more about experiment. In certain things, you will want to represent a population, and from that you want to take a sample and tell about the population. To describe that, there are two things. Again, there standard deviation and the accuracy one. So if you want a very accurate estimation about your population, that is called as margin of error. And what is the variability in the sample you have taken? That is heterogeneity of your sample. So from that, you have a nice formula. So I can just mail it to you. You can send me a question. And that will give us what could be the sample size. Again, there you have to give your level of confidence of alpha as well as the accuracy you want. More accurate you want, more sample size should be taken from the sample. And okay. Again, the same thing now, nowadays, they because it's a COVID period, they do studies for corona or some other disease estimation in our own veterinary field. There, that will also include the prior data. That is, prior data is whatever is available in terms of incidence. So there is one formula including the incidence for sample size calculation in such case.
Okay. There's a question on for a survey study, how to determine the sample size? Survey study.
Survey study, again, it depends on, like, our blocking here. You have another term they use is, instead of blocking here, they use a stratified random sampling. That's a very big subject again. So first thing is, again, there your parameters will be your questionnaire. So based on the questionnaire, you identify the response variables and the total population and the distribution and how you want to block to remove the heterogeneity in the area. For example, usually if you want to do a study in Tamil Nadu, if something is dependent on the district or something, you can take district as a block. Otherwise, usually for several studies, we take the agroclimatic zones, because that has better classification in terms of climate, weather, all those things when we do something for our own veterinary or animal systems.
Okay. So again, I think the similar question somebody has asked. While conducting an exploratory research, how can we decide an effect size?
Yeah, effect size, usually, see, this even I thought I should have been more clear. That is, whatever we have explained till slide 9 is actually a preparatory stage. So exploratory analysis for our data comes afterwards. So one thing is the preliminary effect size for sample size, you should take from available data or available reports which has been done under similar conditions. So once we have our data, effect size, again, you can just a simple Cohen's d can be got, or you have nice R scripts that give you effect size in terms of, I told you, the R, B and odds ratio. And that effect size, when you calculate from that, you not only tell that that effect is significant or not, you also get a confidence interval for that effect size. And an experiment with the effect size and confidence interval is better than just the p-value alone.
Okay. So one, I think one participant has asked, please explain allocation ratio N2 by N1 in G power.
Yeah, in G power. So I told you we are using an independent t-test. In an independent t-test, we have one treatment and one control. So sometimes what we do is we may think that we need a lesser sample size for control and more for our treatment, because there is an issue in the availability of animals or something. In such a case, N2 by N1 is nothing. You just divide our treatment divided by control. If both are equal, you get a 1. But always power will be maximum for equally numbered experiment.
Okay. So I think somebody is unmuting. Please mute. Okay. Sir, actually, there are many questions coming up. I'll ask few questions and then we'll close now. So, other than guideline-based studies, we have fixed number of sample size. Do we have any established guidelines or standard reference to refer for fixing the sample size for various efficacy studies?
Yeah, I should have told you that itself. I missed it out. Actually, whenever there are guidelines from world bodies like OAE or something for their studies, especially in pharmacology, maybe in toxicology studies. In such cases, whenever you have regulations, they have taken into consideration all these things and they have given you the guidelines. And if that has been reported, that you can just refer the guidelines and you can use, nobody is going to question you about the sample size. The question of sample size comes out when you are doing a new extension of a biological experiment and you have to justify the usage of animals, because it has to answer both animal welfare as well as you have to get maximum results from your studies.
Okay, so I think I'll close with one comment from Dr. A. Sankaranarayanan, President Vivo Bio, CEO Vivo Bio, and his comment is, in these digital days, it is easy to lose.
Please mute.
Just a minute. So in these digital days, it is easy to lose sight of the trend of the experimental data. It is common to run a computer even before examining your experimental data and review the trend of the raw data. It is also important to have a good idea how to choose your statistical method for a particular experimental design, as it is easy to choose several methods in series and see which one gives the best significance. So this is the comment from Dr. A. Sankaranarayanan. So I think we'll close the meeting. I think thank you so much, sir. And I'll request Dr. President of ISVPT, to give a final comment on the webinar and future webinars.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan. I thank Dr. Venkatramanan for a nice, just in-depth talk on the important topic, which is useful for all the researchers of all science disciplines. He has already narrated about sample size, p-values, and various statistical software which are available. So this topic will be very much useful to the all the researchers. Now, please note that this recording will be available on our website afterwards. And now, all the participants, please note that our next speaker is Dr. Punya Murthy. He'll be delivering talk on ethnoveterinary, and he's a prominent worker on ethnopharmacology. So don't miss that talk also, because most of the laboratories or the departments are working on the ethnopharmacology. So that will be very much useful. So the date is 8 August, coming month at 11 o'clock. Please note that one. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. I request Dr. Bhavsar to give a final conclusion.
So, I will not take much time. So already Dr. Thakur thanked Dr. Venkatraman. So again, I from ISCPT, I thank Dr. Venkatraman for nice presentation and the discussion. I am also thankful to all the dignitaries, those who are present, those who have remained present for the whole session, as well as all the executive committee members of the ISCPT, those who have remained present. I am also thankful to all the live members of the society who remained present, as well as the success of the webinar could not be there if all the participants were not there. So I am highly thankful to all the participants who remained present for the this webinar. So the webinar videos will be available on the YouTube. Just you can go to the YouTube and search for the ISCPT, and you will get the complete video of the webinar. So that you can see later on also. And already Dr. Thakur has announced the next webinar. So once again, I am thankful to one and all, and especially my team, Dr. Srinivasan and Dr. Ratnadeep, for making the webinar a grand success. Once again, thank you all. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank participants. I will display again the link for feedback form. So it is mandatory to fill the feedback form to get the e-certificate. So kindly fill the feedback form. So I'll again give the link in the chat box as well as the presentation slides. So it will be open for next 1 hour. So I request all the participants to please fill the feedback form. Thank you, 1 hour.
Oh, that.